Did you guys come up with that name?
Which answer do you want?
A.
My favorite one is those true crime magazines.
Yeah.
And in the very back pages sometimes they have this like cross reference thing of like crimes, and like mostly it's murder, and they have like scene of crime and weapon used and like number of occurrences, right? And there was one that was like steel pole in the bathtub, you know, and it was like, I don't know, like 10 or 20 occurrences.
Is this the real answer?
Right? Well, of course not. That's a good one though, to me.
Thank you.
it's really, I mean, the truth is just, it's such an art show. I really like my relationship. It just really is meaningless. It's really boring. Originally, it was actually the steel pole bathtub shower booth bleeding milk pole. And we finally tried, you know, we made these posters, and the poster would be like, the whole thing's like, yeah. It was just like, this isn't going to work. That's where milk pole comes
from. Milk pole, yeah. How did you guys like working with that whole team with your history?
That was really fun, but, you know, that was, we actually did that like over 3 years ago, you know. And it took the author like 2 years to do this. We wrote the entire thing and recorded it in like 3 days, right? All the music. And then it took him 2 years to do the vocals and get it out. So like when we did it, yeah, I know. So the music, I love the music on that record still. Like I really like it a lot. But the vocals just made it, you know. This is off the record. He knows that. I told him, you know. Like I'm pretty straight.
We did a lot of reviews too. It's like,
yeah.
Well, the music's great.
Thank you.
band particularly, it's because we can release like almost 2 hour sets for like the last year almost. And we find that we're just like driving everybody into the ground, you know. So we decided to make them shorter, just consciously, you know, to change things. But yeah, I guess for you, like, by the last time we were here, it was like shorter again, yeah.
Thank you.
That's cool, yeah. What's the name of your band?
Skywall.
Skywall?
Skywall, yeah.
Cool.
Power pop on here.
I like power pop.
Yeah. They got a record coming out in a couple days. Are you putting it out yourself?
Circled Underground. It's a new label here. They're from DC.
Wow.
Yeah.
And they say moved out here and...
Yeah.
That's cool.
The guy's father's a diplomat. Cool. He likes to have the label in Guatemala.
Cool. That's great.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. You don't have to put it out yourself.
You
get that paper
recording.
Yeah, that's not too bad. Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, we are lucky we never had to put our own record out. I mean, I know people who do it and it works really well, but we're just way too lazy.
You guys started off on Boner records?
Actually, yeah, we were on Boner pretty much. The first thing we ever did on vinyl was on Lookout. You know, it was one of that huge compilations. That's our first real recording ever.
You guys came from Montana with it?
Dale and I grew up there, yeah. And Darren's from Seattle. We actually started in Seattle. And we split. Like, we were kind of part of that scene when it was really small, you know. But we were, like, a little bit out of here. And we split just in time. And then we became huge, you know what I mean? I mean, assuming just in time that you don't want to become a part of
cool. You guys in San Francisco now?
Yeah. Yeah, I like it there. Darren, like, lived in New York for a while, and then he's been living in Seattle with him. But we get back together and practice, you know. It works out. We don't all have to live together anymore.
That's cool.
Which is nice. Because he and I have another band that we have that we do.
What's it called?
Milk Cult.
Milk Cult? Yeah, I just bought that.
You have to be careful because some of the Milk Cult covers actually have Foreskin 500 on the inside. And so it's really like, these guys, we actually were like, yeah man, it's cool you guys have that Milk Cult record, but there's actually two different records, right? You know, I was like, well, yes, but that's a mistake, you know. It was depressing plan.
Who's the guy that did all the films?
Oh, Frank Rowe, yeah.
Red and Rosie?
Yeah. It's funny because Love God's not actually out yet. We released the soundtrack record first, you know.
Yeah.
He hasn't actually finished it yet, actually.
Is that film? Yeah. It's like a real short little...
The Red and Rosie is about 20 minutes, and Love Cut is supposed to be a feature, but when we did the work for it, the original work was for the trailer, like about 15 minutes, and Frank is really cool. Supposedly he's got plenty now to do a feature, so we'll go back into the studio and actually do a full soundtrack for it.
That's cool.
It's me and Dale, the bass player, and then this guy Eric Hallman, who's actually from Phoenix originally, but he's like recorded our last few albums and that CD single that we did, you know. And
it's something with the Rollout Pinterest.
Was it
DJ?
Oh, yeah, it's Mark Brooks, who's in Fortune 500, which is really funny that their records would end up in that art. But, he came and did some scratching for us, and Darren played some drums, and...
That's pretty unusual.
Yeah, it is. It's kind of strange, but, yeah, it's totally a noise. Our next ones are going to be even weirder, but it's halfway done, because it's all songs, right? But it's all guest vocalists, and, like, Mike Patton from Faith No More singing on it, and, Mars from Herodes Eric produced that actually too. He's the other guy in the book right now. And Carlo from Edmund Clark. I'm trying to get Buzz from the Melbourne system. And so it's kind of noisy like that, but it's more like groovy. Almost dance, but not quite. It's too weird to be dance, you know what I mean? So. I'm kind of excited about that. That should be finished this summer. We like to keep busy. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
be worth it.
Really?
PR. You'd
have to use all the
bullshit. That's cool.
You know, have you ever gotten to go inside?
Nobody gets to go inside. No, you can't go inside, but man, that's like a little commune. It's really cool.
That is cool. That's really amazing.
I really like it.
Get all that.
Doesn't that stuff freak you out?
Yeah.
Yeah, no shit.
We videotaped our whole tour in Europe this last time.
Yeah.
That was.
And it was great. It was really fun.
But after a while, you kind of used to it. And at first, just like,
Yeah, it's
running around and
bending those
all people.
I know, they were there last night.
I mean, they're
We played this place called the Paradise. It's like the woman there, it's a sun club. Yeah, it's a mouth club, exactly. It was one of those places where you shove in his coffee.
Oh, God.
You know, like,
there he is. And those guys are all, like, really huge fans, but they're just all, like,
crack.
They make
them
say.
Yeah.
They're here for the rock.
We heard you guys play Yuma.
Yeah, that was really fun. Actually, except for Spoon played before us, and everybody thought they were us. I mean, because nobody knew who any of us were anyway. And so everybody like laughed, except for people who knew who we were. So it was kind of cool. We ended up playing a huge room to like, I don't know, 50 people.
Really?
I like it down there.
Yeah, that's
right.
Okay,
got it.
We just like
carted
out together.
It was really weird because they like a fire, you know, and I grew up in Montana, so when we had keggers, we'd have fires, but it'd be really cold out. And here we are, and it's just like, 100 degrees, and they have a fire. You know, since I was like,
for light, more than
yeah, exactly. It's like, you know, well, what else do you do in a cave? Like, stand around a fire, you know? Like, I just thought it was really funny that they actually had a fire in the desert.
Yeah,
it's pretty universal, I guess.
Tonight.
like on a full tour right now, or what?
Yeah, like 2 months.
For the new album?
Yeah. And it's the first time we've ever done it when the album came out, which is the way it's supposed to be.
Right, of course.
We totally never have done anything the way we're supposed to do it.
It seems kind of cool if you like let the album come out and then go a little after it. So
yeah.
Everyone knows the song.
It's like
right.
Fugazi, they always come here right before their album.
Right before, see,
every tour they always
do that. You don't know the song. Yeah.
Well, see, the thing is if we did that, it'd be even worse, because but if we waited, let's say, another 2 weeks, we probably wouldn't play any songs from the new album. They'd be all songs for the next album, because we're really inconsiderate that way. We don't care what the audience really thinks that much. I don't know if we care what they think, but if they, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's not why we play the film.
I know, so the first time I was playing it, seriously. I was expecting more songs that I was familiar with.
Yeah, we probably get better reactions from the crowd, because then they can go, I know that song, but we're pretty selfish. That was actually, in essence, was the very first Milk Cult recording, because Eric, we kind of started it, and it would have been actually good if we had finished it, but, I mean, I think it's kind of terrible, actually, personally, but we ended up just, we had to go on tour, and I gave it to Eric and just said, here, you just put a bunch of samples on there, finish it up, you know, and so he did that. And the other one is the R.E.M.
Yeah,
that's actually a Milk Cult recording, too. That album is terrible, but I think our song's really good.
I like the one you guys did. It's all like billiard ball.
Yeah, well, it's just like, it kind of, it's the only thing after the fact that we do sample their songs, like R.E.M. songs, but on the original recording, it's like, you know, but in the beginning, there's like this really low rumble that goes, and I read in an interview or heard an interview like years ago where Peter Fox said that that was them playing pool at, I don't know, what's his name, producer guy, whatever the fuck his name was, if I weren't totally spaced out, I don't know, but, and then they just slowed it down, right? And I always thought that was really cool, like, really, you know, like a guy can ask the other name to stand and stuff. And so that's why it's totally this inside joke, like, you know, oh yeah, here's the song.
That's cool though.
You guys keep your sampler at it, you can see it.
It's on all really small tape decks.
It's already loose in
it. Yeah, tape loose on cassette. I mean, in the studio it's all computerized, yeah. You know, the whole 9 yards. But on tape, it's too hard to take samplers on tour. Yeah. It's too expensive.
Can't even see them behind you guys? Or?
They're actually on top of the amplifiers, but they're like on these tapes. So
I think I saw one of them.
Yeah, I don't know where the other person
is. There was one on the floor between the drums and the bass amp.
That was probably Dale. Yeah. Oh, I know. That's a good idea. Because then you can get the pulpit part of that. Probably didn't it stink?
I guess I should clean up.
Yeah, we did that with your single and stuff.
I was sent here from the train with these 3 days ago, sir. I expected you here a little sooner. This is mail for both.
Looks like everybody left.
How happy this makes me, sir. Now I can get out of here if I can find a way. You're in the asshole of the world, Captain!
You guys are really cool, man.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Is that an Ampeg head you're playing through?
No.
Is that a tube head or what?
It has these weird tubes in it, but it's mostly solid state. Yeah. It has like a preamp tube, I guess, for you to open up.
How second is that? I haven't got it.
So I wanted to get one of those cool, big, giant, old SDPs.
Yeah.
But everyone I know has was like, well, you should have two. So that when one's broken, you can use like, the other one. It's like,
more money than you want to do.
Ready? Come up at the door and pan him right over here. Everybody ready?
Beautiful.